evening and welcome to the legendary Gold Coast Hotel and Casino and National Finals tonight. Brought to you in part by Kentucky Fire, Maker's Mark, Pinnacle Vodka, Coors, 14 Hands Vineyards, Cooper Tires, Ram Rodeo, Justin Boots, National Cowboy Museum, Wrangler, Montana Silversmiths, Resist All Hats, Pepsi, Boyd Gaming. National Finals tonight with 8-time world champion bull rider Donnie Gay, 8-time world champion cowboy Joe Beaver, and the men and women of the NFL. Sit back, relax, and enjoy National Finals tonight. And now, here's your host, award-winning television personality, Mr. Dan Miller.
What a great-looking crowd. My goodness, we're glad to have you with us tonight. Folks, right down front. I like it when that happens. Welcome to National Finals tonight. This is our 8th season of doing this show, and we are honored to have you with us here tonight. A great night at the rodeo, and we're told now the 5 millionth fan from the 30 years the NFR has been in Las Vegas went through the doors at the Thomas and Mack tonight. Pretty darn impressive. 5 million people. That's great coming here to watch the rodeo. We've got a lot of things to do with you here this evening, including giving away great prizes and guitars signed by George Strait. It's going to be a good night. Let's get started and bring out our co-hosts here. If you'll allow me to do that, this first gentleman, no stranger to any of you, he is the best ever bull rider in my book. 8-time world champion Donnie Gay is in the house tonight. Donnie, come on out.
All right. Thank you. Bragged on me. You bragged on me. You're being nice. What's that called?
It's coming. Something is coming. You know that, huh?
I know that.
Wasn't it good tonight?
I'm a little nervous. You know, I had as much fun tonight as I've had all week.
Yeah.
I mean, the bull riding was out there. How many of y'all like the bull riding tonight?
Yeah. Perfect. Yeah. Perfect. A little bit of everything.
Yeah, looked like they belonged. They sure did.
Let's get our other co-host out here and get this evening started. He also is an 8-time world champion, you know that, and just a great guy as well. Joe Beaver is here. Would you welcome Joe Beaver to me?
He finally enjoyed the rodeo?
Really enjoyed the rodeo.
He really enjoyed
it. That means that tall bull rider was good, wasn't it?
Yes. How are you tonight, Joe?
Lovely, lovely. And you? How are you?
Well, it's been an interesting time here in Las Vegas for me. Let me just tell you quickly. Last night I had a little incident with the police.
Wait a minute. Let me preface this with this guy has never had a drink of alcohol, never tasted tobacco or anything. You know, had a full scholarship, played football at the University of Indiana, rock and roll musician. Ultimate nice guy. Now go ahead.
I thought you was talking about me for a minute. I thought he was talking about me. Buckwheat, you hush back there.
No, Joe, I was not talking about you.
This has been an interesting time for me. First, the other night when it was raining here in Las Vegas, was it Tuesday, our first Tuesday before anything started? I stopped to get fuel at a gas station. I left my truck door open then. I went in to pay and I came back out. There's a dog in my truck.
Was his name Donnie?
No, this was a big dog.
A real dog, big dog.
Oh, I love this show.
And I could not get this dog out of my truck because of the. I had to go in and get a Slim Jim because every time I try to grab this dog, she started growling. And so I go in and I finally get a Slim Jim and coax that. So I knew it was going to be a rough time. The first canine prostitute I've ever seen. Couldn't get her in, couldn't get her out of here. Finally, the Slim Jim gets her out. And
it's not mine.
The Slim Jim?
Slim, yeah.
So last night, I'm going back to my hotel. I stay a little outside of town in St. George. So I was driving outside, and I was at Desert Inn and Jones at the intersection.
Deadest place in Las Vegas.
The deadest? I take that because there's nobody out there. It's just... So I go across the intersection, and all of a sudden, I hear this crash. I'm jerked backward, and sparks, and a motorcycle hits me at 70 miles an hour on Desert End Boulevard. And beside me, the motorcycle, nobody on it, he's underneath my truck. The motorcycle goes by me spinning.
Looked like a movie, Transformers.
Looked like sparks flying. And this motorcycle goes 274 feet. Now, you know, Joe, in a big arena, almost a football field, this motorcycle
You thought your gas tank exploded, probably, didn't you? I mean, you didn't know what hit you.
Scared me. And I look in my rearview mirror, and there's this guy down. And I'm thinking, he's dead. He is face down, dead, laying
he's
in the...
He's done.
Done because he hit me that hard at the, and his he was going in and out of traffic, like this.
Doing the ninja.
He was on a crotch rocket and came in and the foot peg hit the pavement, and so it brought him under my truck. He went under my truck and stopped.
Right now,
and the motorcycle kept on
going.
I tell
you how hard he stopped. He had lace up boots. It was laced up, and one of them was on the top, the cab of his truck, as he went to get back in it.
Yeah, the guy from the ambulance said, "What's on the top of your truck?" I said, "That's his shoe."
Was his foot in there?
No, it wasn't, but it was still all laced up and tied. It was still all laced up. Now, the good news
is... I hate this story, because the guy lives, and he wears a helmet. He's got the whole suit.
Yep.
Seriously, I'm glad the guy lived, but...
I was going to say,
everybody's going to want to wear a damn helmet. You know, if you wear a cowboy hat, all you got to do is know how to drive.
I just thought it was kind of unique that you worried about the helmet more than a guy living.
Let me do an Obama. Maybe I misspoke.
Anyway, they called me at 3 a.m. The police officer did, and he said, "By golly, he's going to make it." So the guy is all right. I had to go get new tires.
Okay, so what did the progressive insurance lady ask you today?
Yeah, his insurance called me today, and she said he has no recollection of an accident at all. Could you tell me what happened? I said, yeah, oh, yeah.
Matter of fact, I can.
I can tell you. But everybody's there, all safe and all well. So it's all. Listen, if you would like to participate in our show tonight, questions are already coming in. We have a text number, and they'll keep putting that across the crawl up there on the screens. But here's the number. It's 702-582-5638. That's 702-LUCK. NFT. The shows are on YouTube. You can go to YouTube and just type in National Finals Tonight if you'd like to see them, or tell anybody to tune in and watch those. And also, highlights are on the Wrangler Network. If you didn't go to the rodeo tonight and you missed it on television, as Donnie and Joe both mentioned, a great rodeo, round number 7. I was telling them, Donnie, 5 million people now have paid and gone through the turnstiles at the Thomas and Mack to watch the National Finals rodeo. We've put together a highlight package, a little bit of everything tonight, guys. A couple of ties, but let's get it started. Do it live for us. Bareback riding right there. Donnie Gay, start us off with Richmond Champion.
All right. Well, this is Richie, the Million Dollar Baby Champion, and this guy is showing you why he won the American, won the $1 million in one day, rides Angel Eyes, 86 points. I mean, this is the second go-around. He's won already $40,000, but he's not done yet. But watch the style. His body, his back is straight down the horse's back. Sets his feet, 86.5 points. It's just outstanding.
Steer wrestling, it was tight tonight. Dakota starts it off. That's the same horse Luke Barranquino was riding. They won about 110,000 already. He thinks he's safe 3-4. Now watch this. This sawhorse, this is where he's good. Watch his head go up and down. He's digging to get by the steer to let him get his feet on the ground. This is a textbook run. He sets his feet, gets the head over the hip, hooks the nose deep, stays up over the nose. He thinks, I just won a day money. I'm going to celebrate. But little do you know, Curtis Cassidy, that steer had all kind of tricks. Curtis Cassidy, if he wasn't from Canada and runs a bunch of steers short barrier, watch this, you don't catch him. Steer steps towards you, gives you a fake, and about time you make your move, he
goes
sets.
To the right, yeah.
Ducks out behind the hazer. Bailey looks back and says, oh, hell, I hope you catch him, because I'm already past him. Now, here's what makes the difference. This steer's got all the momentum taken away. Curtis Cassidy has a left arm big as a watermelon, and he hits him with it right there. 3-4, they split the round. Team Roving, Dustin Bird has won 2 rounds on Grigger's Yellow Horse. Tonight he gets back on his, makes it look easy, but the reason the round is so fast and they win, watch Paul Eves, the healer, on the gray horse. He measures him off. His horse is already stopping when he throws. He gets the rope tight, lets Dustin get faced before the fence. 3-7, that's it.
All right, the saddle bronc riding. This is where it all starts. Classic event of rodeo. These are the rank horses. These are the best horses in the business right here. And you're going to watch the best bronc rider match up. Spencer Wright, pretty boy. That was the nicest horse in the pen, 85 points. It reminded me of the bull riding a little bit. We bucked off more bronc riders tonight. I mean, everybody hitting the ground. But this one right here, they can't all be so rank you can't ride them. And Spencer Wright, he don't waste one very often, and didn't there, just spurred the hair off of him.
Tied out rope with Tough Cooper. Last night missed the Dooley bug, the loper. He's supposed to win the round. Goes and practices today. Tonight, turns it around. It's his buckle to lose. Look what this boy does really good. He's big, he's strong. See the front end? The calf comes up. Calf never gets the advantage. He's got him flanked. Two wraps to Nui, 7-3. Thinks he's safe, and here it comes, Cody. Cody comes across, throws the bomb, misses the slack, jumps off, flanks Rap Mahui. Everything Tough did right, Cody did wrong, but the time was the same. Big curl right there, misses the slack. He says, I don't need my slack. He attacks this calf on the ground, and he's going to put a Rap Mahui on anything he catches this week. He's trying to win all he can.
My two fantasy 7-3s. Guy, yeah.
Mine too, you bet. Oh, here comes Lisa.
Okay, let's don't brag on the ground too early before we get going here.
Let her go at the top of the ground. Let her set the pace, and she'll take a victory lap. Lisa Lockhart, she's got the best right leg in rodeo on the first barrel. She kicks that right, well, ain't quite like that, but she kicks the right leg up. It actually bends more and comes over, keeps her from hitting the first barrel. Louie runs good. She wins a round.
All right, Bull Rider showed up tonight, and it was outstanding. Elliot Jacoby is going to turn back and ride one just like everything's supposed to. This kid from Texas, I've been telling everybody, this guy can really, really ride. Watch that. Watch this one more time. I want you to watch the bull. Watch his feet. He's got probably six chances to buck off. There was one. Gets set back down. Now starts down inside, now outside. Now back perfect. Finishes it off. What a nice bull ride. Made that bull look easy. 86 and a half points, and he's one of the first two guys that scores. But guess what? The world number one, Sage Kimsey, they score him the same, 86 and a half. Almost made a little mistake trying to spur him at the end. Gets it done. I thought Elliott should have won the round by himself. You know, you just watch it back. But the judges don't get to watch it in slow motion. They don't get to watch the replay. And this is a really pretty ride. I'm not demeaning it in any way. But Elliott Jacoby rode a much tougher bull.
He rode a nasty bull. He rode a good bull.
Good bull, yeah.
Outstanding job, guys. Nicely done. Give him a hand, if you will. Very good.
Oh, and my buddy J.W. Harris.
Yes.
You know, if y'all went to the rodeo, you saw a Shaps tonight.
Did your mother-in-law make those?
No, they were kind of cute, though, weren't they? That rainbow stuff,
yes,
you know, that they talk
nice.
About. And everything.
Hey, working for Fallon. He thought he tried.
He got them from Fallon.
There you go, sir.
He did.
There you go.
Okay, but on a serious note, he rode in them tonight. They're going to auction them off tomorrow at the South Point at the ladies' luncheon. You can buy a ticket, go in there and bid on them. You know, J.W. made the whistle in place. He may be trying to buy them himself, you know. But
it's one of them deals you might pay for them now and pick them up Sunday.
But on the tees, on the TV before the rodeo started, you know, and it's live TV, they can't make you take it back. I said, yeah, J.W. has cracked out a new wardrobe, and they might be calling him the Gay Caballero.
The truck,
he's going to kill me when he sees me tomorrow.
The earpiece from the truck went.
Love's a wonderful thing, isn't it, huh? We've got another question, but Joe, I want to do this first. Donnie, we put together kind of a mini rec reel. I'm just going to call this guys that are going to be sore tomorrow.
You haven't seen the Justin room gets tomorrow.
Well, these guys especially.
There's a longer line out of the Justin room than there is at the buffet.
Let's take a look at this, starting with Will Lowe and the presence of mind on him, Donnie. His horse goes down, but watch him make good out of bad.
Okay, horse falls down. He's got his hand wedged in. He rides right-handed, horse falls left. He's not going to get out. So he knows he's got to get on the other side. Check this out. He's been here 13 times. That's why
he's been
he's
there
not
before,
hurt.
Too.
So that's happened, but you talk about presence of mind. Now, we got Tim O'Connell. He's had a couple of horrible wrecks. Watch this. Yeah, both back feet right on his leg. That'll leave a mark. I'm telling you, that was tough. But, you know, then you go to the bull riding, and we got those weather guard bullfighters. Okay, that bull's got Trey Benton. That looks like Chuck Swisher just taking one. I mean, if there's any air in the building, somebody needed to help him get it. But, I mean, he just takes it because he knows Trey's going to get it. Well, that wasn't the only wreck tonight. Cody Webster tore his MCL, but he's just taping up and going on with it.
Rough night.
And Chuck's okay. He got his air back finally.
Rough
night. Yeah, looks it.
Joe, let's do this real quickly, and then there's a couple of things I want to show you. It says, how long does it take to train a horse to keep basically a calf horse? It's a lifetime, basically.
How long to teach them to keep the rope tight? I'll be honest, some horses it takes forever, and some it's quick. There's all kinds of ways. You know, people work them on logs in the arena. People work them in narrow areas. And the last really good horse that I ever had, that one of them, the last one my dad trained, he was old, he was impatient, and he never did anything to him but turn calves around near the rope and let us break in a herd of 50. That horse was smart enough to know that was what he's supposed to do, and we rodeoed on him in 3 weeks. So it depends on the horse. And if he doesn't want to get back and he doesn't catch it after a while, he never will, because you're away from him. That's why tie-down horses cost so much money, because team roping, bulldog, and everything. When you turn a bulldog horse loose, all he has to do is run. When you're in a team roping, you're always in their hand, in the mouth with them. You can control them. But a tie-down horse, once you get off, it's like dropping a girl off with a Black American Express at the mall. If she wants to screw you, she can.
What an analogy.
Well put.
You know, and then it could be a conundrum.
Oh, yeah, I hate those, yeah, yeah.
If then, you like her.
Then you need salve. All right, let's, Joe, we've talked about people making mistakes and it being costly. I want to show you this first in the steer wrestling. Jeremy, if you've got that racked up back there. Kyle Irwin tonight.
And this is just, okay, he gets tight, and he gets bumped up out of the saddle you couldn't see. But now once you make a mistake like that, and you get your determined and you're mad, this kid, you couldn't have pried him off this steer with two chainsaws and a big chain. He was determined to throw him down. Is that good? Is that going to win anything? Probably not, but look at him. He's like, ugh, bad or good. See right there, he goes over the left horn. Now right here, he should just let him go and just go on back to the chute. But it's his first time in the national finals. He's got something to prove. He doesn't want to be called a wimp. He wants to keep throwing him down. Who knows about the average later? Who doesn't? But that kid's got some will to win.
Unbelievable effort. Unbelievable effort. And I'll tell you, those horns came darn close to him when he was pulling that steer back around.
I can tell you he was probably upset. That right there, in the horse riding events, that's akin to riding your horse and going to take an introduction, and the horse drops his head, just bucks one time, you go over the saddle horn, and the last thing you see between your legs is that horse's ears. It's really hard to look cool there.
I remember when we were doing Mesquite Rodeo.
I did it, yeah.
Well, your dad, it happened to your dad one time. His dad just began to
win. In front of the king of Monaco, yeah. I mean,
took out Patrick Smith, if y'all remember here.
That's
world
right.
Champion. You know, the world champion
grand
team roper.
Horse.
Getting his introduction, the first performance. He's in that cute little white saddle those girls ride, and he goes to tip his hat, and that white saddle horn winds up right there, and about takes him out from the whole national finals. Bucks him off, hangs his foot, hits the ground, and all they could talk about was, boy, that gold bucket looked good when it was facing up to Thomas and I.
Oh, boy, it's hard to live down.
I literally saw Joe 15 seconds before I came out here, but I want to show you this run with Jake Barnes.
Yeah.
And it was almost...
This is a heartbreaker anyway, because we just talked to Junior, but here's the deal. All right, Jake's in the winning the average. When he ropes that steer, you see he fouls his slack the first time. Well, this horse is going left. Watch this. About the time he ropes him right here, see, he gets his slack and drops it, and he goes to stack it on the horn. Now, let's go back a few years.
Yes.
Right at the same spot in that arena, and I think a Palomino horse, if I'm not wrong. Jake Barnes is roping through the week, and he sticks it on one right there, and he goes, he misses his slack the same way. And instead of him doing this, watch his right hand. Okay, bobs the slack. See how he's up, both hands are out here? He stacks it on that saddle horn, bows up, and cuts his thumb off. Off. So I'm going to say that it didn't enter his mind but till about right. Nope. we're still all right. Right there, that this is about where it happened last time. And in this horse, you can see a lot of horses. That's what I don't like about head horses that aren't built real level or real flat. When a head horse sticks his head up in the air, he will pinch his neck to that saddle horn.
You cannot get by.
And if he'd have ever got past the neck the first time, he would have been 50-50. Can you hold it? That's what cut his thumb off before. But Jake Barnes has got so much determination, will. I was thinking to myself on TV, don't do it, don't do it, don't do it. Because a lost rope is a whole hell of a lot better than a lost thumb. So they're one steer down. They can still win third or fourth in the average. But I hate it because yes. Junior was really wanting to win that average.
Yep, and Junior was with us last night. Great, great young man. I almost hesitate to show you this, Joe, but we've alluded to it earlier in the week. But Rich Skelton and Nick Sartain, let's just go ahead and look at it. But you can say snake bit, you can say whatever you want, but goodness.
You can say snake bit for the first couple. But then after that, Nick Sartain's a world champion. Go figure out why you're not catching. I mean, watch this. He's got a big old swing. His elbow's high. It's over his head. His horse is moving, but he's not moving as much as he thinks because watch his body. His body's moving away from the steer more so than his horse.
That rope didn't touch the steer.
No, his target's not moving near like he thinks. But every time a guy shifts his hip, it's not like the bull ride. You're not going to get bucked off. But you shift your hips and you throw at your target. You've taken everything off your rope. Watch this. Okay, the horse, he's not going to. Watch, he doesn't drop like he thinks, but look how far his hips are over here on the left. So when he throws, he's coming around with it. That steer takes 1 6-inch step. It's like him moving 18 miles. But again, he's a world champion. He's got an 8-time world champion behind him, and I like him. He's a good friend of mine. But go watch some tape and figure out what in the hell it takes to catch. Because a header, we have 3 legal head catches. In case y'all don't know, it's around the horns, half head, or neck. So surely to be God for $20,000 a night, when I missed one, the next night I figured out somehow how to catch one of those because you know what Rich Skelton wants? He just wants a chance. He'll win you money.
I agree.
I love watching Joe B whenever he was roping calves and everything, but I'd have hated like hell to have been his team roping partner.
I went through a lot of healers. Trust me. They all talk about it's a teamed event. And as if it's such a teamed event, why the hell did you rope a leg when you win?
We've got a team roper, speaking of that, to get out here. And let's just
a real, real healer waiting in the wings.
And world champion.
And you'd actually have to be nice to this guy.
I'd have to pay this guy to rope with me.
World champ the last 2 years. Jade Corkill is here this evening. Would you welcome Jade?
Come on out, Jade.
You know, and we talked about earlier, Dan, how important it was, and when people do good, they want to come. When they don't do good, you know, Jade's had okay finals, but like tonight went nothing like they had planned. And you know, one text, "Are you coming?" And yes, sir, I'll be there. That's the difference makers we talk about what champions do, and champions understand that the other people don't. It's still about taking care of the public. It's still about taking care of your sponsors. It's still about it's okay. We still got 4 steers left.
I told Jade when he came in tonight, thank you so much for coming, Jade. But I told him I was more impressed with what he did tonight to make that thing.
The first thing I said to him is I said, great decision. Because if you take a bad throw right there and then, you know, Jake, he does what he does, well, then you're even with Trevor on a steer down. That just opens the door to give the buckle up. And Jade's in a unique position because I think Rich Skelton probably is the last guy to win multiple championships back to back. Well, this could be number 3, and he's young and talented. We could get Rich's dynasty.
I agree. Talk about, and let's go ahead and take a look at the run. And Jade, you talk about it tonight because that very impressive to me. Your choices.
Well, tonight, like where we were at, there's only 2 teams, us and Jake and Junior, that had them all caught. So it's kind of a tough spot, you know, in our position because we do have a chance for the world title and stuff. So. You got to be on go because we want to win something, but you also have to be able to shut that off if you need to because we can't take a no time either. So, like tonight, we kind of knew that steer maybe went a little bit left. Tom Richards had him the first night, and he was pretty good. And then Eric Rogers and Corey had him in the 4th round. And I told Clay that since the last couple kind of went left, that I might just see a little bit since we knew he probably wouldn't go right. And then he said that when he kind of hesitated a little bit, he pulled and then he was a little bit late, and then we got over there, and you know, I kind of knew on the way to him that the day money was probably out of the, or placing was probably out of the question, and just tried to not
get
a no time.
Let me interrupt real quick. Look, you don't know people how hard it is to heal one right there.
I was just going to say, how many times have you seen somebody wait to come off the wall to take a safe shot to get a time, and just about the time they throw, that steer cuts back under the limb. I thought Clay did a great job keeping that steer, because once he comes off the wall, man, he had him going where you could get a good shot at him.
Yeah, it's kind of hard, like right about, like right there. It's kind of like towing a tube on a boat. It's when you come back with the boat and the tube gets to whipping, that's, but where I, what I was kind of doing there, because I was right about there, I was wanting to throw, and then I just can't, each, like, you can tell my horse is just gaining, and I'm still never catching up, really. And then right there was kind of the point. I didn't really see Harry in the moment. But
I'm on TV
TV thinking, Harry, move, because, you know, that's what drives the steer back under right there in a minute anyway. Yeah, that was just an impressive shot. I know you were four flat, but people don't realize how hard that shot was and how important that run could be.
Yeah, we're here
for
all
world
week.
Championship.
That's right. But I wasn't wanting to throw there either, but I knew that it gets even worse if they get going back straight. So.
Oh, terrible.
Very impressed. As I mentioned, you're reigning champ two times in a row now. Donnie and Joe can add to this as well. Does it get easier? Does that pressure now that you're building up? Talk about that.
It's. I mean, there's not really any pressure. I mean, there is. I mean, on myself, you know, but nothing, you know, from anyone else. It's. I mean, it's a dream come true for me to even get one. And I think it takes actually being out there and doing it to understand what Speed and Rich really truly did do. And it's amazing what they did to do it eight in a row, just to even rope together that long. You know, since I've been out here, this is my ninth year, and nobody's roped together the whole time. So even that in itself is a feat. And on top of it, dominating like they did and winning it, because it's hard to win it. You can win. I've been in the lead a lot on nine head and not won it. And it's just one more steer, but it means a big difference. And so plan on doing it, but I'm after it just because it has happened twice and I have a chance again. So I'm going to give it all I got.
And people are loving watching you and talking about it. Joe, I've got, I think this is night number one where you and Clay, and I believe this is like a 4-7, but you can take a look at it and talk about this one.
This steer, well, the first night here, you know, they're supposed to be kind of the stronger pin, and it is important to get the week kind of started off good here, at least with a catch. So that steer, when we ran him through, I thought he was, you know, one of the stronger ones, just not as far as speed, but like kind of how he handled. He kind of hit like this and hit fast and kind of wanted up the rope the other day. So I was just trying to, you know, take the best shot I could. And the round wasn't just super tough when we went. We were last out. So 4-7 is not that hard to be in there if you get a good steer. So I was just trying to win something and move on.
We've run 7, right? 8, 9, 10. How many rounds y'all placed in? 3?
We had placed in 4 coming in, so 4 out of 7.
And I'm going to tell you, and we don't have it on film, I bet. We showed it the other night about the dally. You know, if y'all were here the one round, which round is that? 4?
The second.
Second round. He heals a steer, and you know, never hardly does a rope come back down in the right between your horse's ears.
That was wild.
And very seldom does it stay there. You know, it usually pops one way or the other, and you have enough rope to dally. I said that night on TV that if he can hold his rope as it was happening, this is going to be a difference maker. Well, they've had 2 out of 7 unique situations that would take a lesser team out of the average. Jade fought till the knot. You know, I mean, he had about that much rope left with both hands trying to get a dally, because when you dally, your saddle was low, you dally at the bottom, you got to hold it. Well, he's trying to dally down low with the rope up over the horse's head.
And not to lose a leg was just...
Didn't lose a leg or the rope, we talked about that night, you know. And very seldom will a horse just take it. And he took it, you know, let you survive.
Yeah, that's what I told Clay. It was funny that I feel like I'm the king at losing legs, and the night that I tried to lose a leg, I didn't. But because I was just thinking, like, I've seen that happen before, you know, if something like a horse or the steer kind of come underneath your horse and it stuff's headed that way. But that was as normal a shot as I've had ever here, maybe, and I've never had that happen. But that's what Joe and I were talking about the other night, that if that had been practicing, I probably would have ended up on my head. But
Because most of the time a horse reacts to that, Jade. Yeah. They're going to, you know, it's a hit. It's not like you reach up there and pet him with the rope. He healed that steer and that rope just whack. And for some reason, you know, usually at home, he'd spin one way or another and you'd be, and this horse just took it. And Jade never lost his composure. If you get a chance to watch a video somewhere slow, he grabs it. He tries to get to the horn. He tries left-handed to get it down. And then finally, with about 2 foot of rope, he just gets him a medallion. Like Donnie said, never lost a leg.
I mean, that was wild, but I'm still having trouble trying to get a visual on being your partner for 7 or 8 years in the team rope and being locked in the same truck with you. Gosh, I just thought bull riding was tough.
Hey, and I'm going to tell you what, it's a different deal now, too, is, you know, next year is going to be a lot of money here. So Jade knows this, if we get three, you get three knocked down, you know, coming in from now on is not going to be as important to be in the lead. It's how much you win right here. So this could be a huge buckle. And Donnie said it before. We know it, and you know it because you got it in here. But, boy, when you go to trying to win 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, it gets tough.
Yeah, once everybody starts talking about you and when you compete and win year after year after year, basically you wind up realizing when they're cussing you, that just means you're winning. And that not in a bad way, but that's just how it is. They don't want anything bad to happen, but they certainly want to beat your butt. And that is always out there. So if you think it's hard to win one world title, wait till you start trying to win another one, and then another one, and then another one. And what you said about Speed and Rich, you know, pretty incredible, because not like the bull riding or any of the other events where you don't have a partner. You got to not only be so good at what you do, you also are totally dependent, in your case, for the quarterback to give you a shot for y'all to win. You know, so I'm impressed.
Jake, what I wanted to say, when Clay was here the other night, I thought he was just very, very honest. He said, because we were talking about how you guys got together and that, and just Clay just said, bottom line is we're the best in the world at what we do right now. And he feels that way about his heading. He feels that way about your healing, the confidence with you guys.
Yeah, I think you know, confidence in your partner has to be a big factor, because even if you are, I mean, even if you win the world, you lose more than you win throughout the year, and you go through a lot more down times, you know, than you do up times. And I think that's, you know, something that I know I made a mistake at when I was younger, is that if it doesn't go good, you can't get to thinking, man, I wonder if I should rope someone else, or I wonder if I should do this or whatever. Like, you have to give it a, I mean, there's times where you know for sure that it's time to move on, but the rest of the time you just got to be on your partner's team, and you can't, like, we go down together, you know what I mean? And not, if he's messing up, well, then it could be something I'm doing. I look at myself, you know, first before, you know, before we look at
what
he's
doing. Well, you're safe because Clay said he believes that you're the best healer in the world, and that's why y'all are roping together.
And you know what else? It's a business. You know, I mean, this is business now. It's a lot of money. It's how he bought a nice place, but he's moved, you know, Clay takes care of his family, so does Jade. So it's important to know that if you are as a team chemistry-driven winning, you don't want to break that. And you got to get along. But I don't see this breaking up because of what y'all do together as a business. Am I right?
Yeah, I think, you know, that a lot of guys, that when they start roping together, they'll, you know, you eat together, yeah, and you, right, you travel together, and you practice together, and you spend a lot of time together. And that's kind of what I've noticed. Is funny, like last year compared to this year we talked less, yeah, and we spent less time together. And we practice less together.
But you won just the same or more.
But I think it's kind of an unsaid thing between us that we know that we want to rope together. And so we don't, like, every time I show up somewhere and see Clay, I'm not tired of seeing him.
That's right.
So because it gets to, no matter how good of friends you are, if you do, you know, if you have enough bad times, yep, it just gets to where you don't like how they chew their food all of a sudden. So if that's how it is, then you set yourself up for failure, you know, before you even get there. So
kind of like that cartoon I saw, that the wife said, honey, why don't you tell me that you love me? And he looked at her and said, hell, I told you that 10 years ago, and if something changes, I'll let you know.
Jade, we're darned impressed, especially with tonight, but We're pulling for you and honored that you made time to come out here with us. And it's
Well, you know, for food for thought. Okay, Clay's wrote great. Clay hadn't faltered. You know, Jade hadn't either. But to me, okay, if it's a world championship this year, there's two steers that stand out. One when he fought to get a dally, and two tonight when he fought to catch.
I agree.
So the quarterback dictates the run, but don't you forget for a minute that the wide receiver scores the touchdown.
Yep, awesome. Would you give him a hand? Jade Corkill, two-time world champion, Healy.
That was nice. Yeah.
Yeah, I just, go ahead, Joe.
Well, though that shot they were just showing, that's easy for those guys. But it's those hard ones here that win the championships. It's just like Donnie talks about that easy, that was just a good bull he rode. But that other bull Elliott rode was a buck or nasty. That's the difference makers in the championships.
And you can't, you can make try to make the pens of livestock as even as you want.
Right, yeah.
You know, calf ropers will tell you, well, you should put this way. It doesn't matter. There's always going to be one in there that's better than the next one. And so, no, Jim Shoulders, I'll say it again. He said, when you got the best one on them, you win first. When you got the sorriest one in the pen, you figure out how to win fourth, and you'll carry home more of those world buckles than anybody else.
Well, and it's still, you know, that still is what keeps the fun in this sport.
Just like him getting his dally and not losing a leg, when that rope's right between his horse's ears, his horse is going, oh, shoot.
It keeps the fun in it because there's no guarantee with two guys, three animals, you can't put all good ones together. And that's the fun
it's
of it.
It's impossible, yeah.
It is. It's like a hand of poker out here. You know, until you turn that card up, you're not sure what you got.
Yep. Awesome. I'm glad Jade came. Let's move on to this next gentleman. He got him an honor this year. PRCA, Clown of the Year. Pretty darn good, huh?
Coors man in a can. How about Justin
Rumford? Justin
Rumford.
Come on up here.
All right. Go through there and get your microphone.
Hey, Dan. The only thing I wish we had was a fence so you could see him in a Spider-Man deal jump on that fence like
and
he does
stick.
The court. Yes.
And stick.
I love that. That's awesome.
Yeah, it's got to be a really strong fence around here. So put on a few pounds this week, Joe.
That's all right. You're doing good. Everybody's laughing.
They gave Justin that buckle, and he was looking at it, and I said, what are you doing, Justin? He said, I'm trying to read what's on front of it because once I put it on, I'll only know who made it.
She gone.
I got that same problem, so I'm right there with you, buddy.
I feel good about it, though. I feel great.
We're so proud of you. Congratulations.
I know, you feel great. Yeah, awesome. Thank you.
Congratulations. Yes.
First. What about being Coors Man in a Can, the Clown of the Year, but actually getting the National Finals Rodeo? What's that mean to you? Because I know who your family is, and so tell everybody else.
Well, you know, it's so funny. Like, ever since my dad, Bronc Rumford's back there, my wife and my sister, and they all know what I've gone through my whole life. I didn't want to play football. I didn't want to play basketball. I didn't want to do anything. All I've ever wanted to do is rodeo. And my best friend, Jeff Rector's here, too. And when we were little, all we would do was watch rodeo. And Dad would fly us out here for one perf. And being a stock contractor, you know how that goes. A lot of times the kids don't get tickets to the rodeo. So a lot of times we just fly to Las Vegas and stand in the parking lot of Thomas and Mack and talk about how cool it'd be to be inside. And that ain't a joke. And so
that's what makes it funny.
So growing up in Abbeville, Kansas, I don't know how many people have been there. It's a town about 105 on a good day, and most everybody there is Amish. And so we didn't have cable. So growing up, when we wanted to watch the national finals, we had to go. There was one guy in town named Bob Jones, and he had a dish, like when it was like NASA, you know? So
We're stealing the signal.
Oh, my goodness. So when me and Jeff were little and we wanted to go watch the NFR after we got back from being in the parking lot of Thomas and Mack, and we'd go over to Bob Jones' house and we'd watch the NFR and we'd put it on VHS tapes. And then we'd just watch it a million times and talk about how much we wanted to be there. And you know, I steer wrestled and and rode Bronx before I was fat, and made the short round of the college finals 3 times. No big deal. No big deal. But, you know, I mean, there's so many kids around here. Like, I see it. Today at the Las Vegas Convention Center, I was doing an autograph signing for my sponsor, Cinch Jeans and Shirts. Great, great people. And I see little kids with ropes. You know, 10-year-old kids roping out in the hallways.
Jealous students.
Yeah, you know, I see these little kids, and I see little kids with chaps, and you know, they just are ate up. And I look at that and go, man, that is me. And all I've ever wanted to do is make the NFR. That's been my goal. I didn't care if it was in the steer wrestling or the bronc riding. I just wanted to be here. So I set a goal in 1986. I drew a picture in kindergarten of a bull with a barrel. And I had to write my goals on the back for my teacher, Mrs. Woodson. God bless her soul. Okay? She gone. Anyhow. But it said, write 3 things you want to do.
Had a coronary trying to teach you.
It said, what are the 3 things you want to achieve in life as a 6-year-old boy? And I said, I want to learn how to drive a semi, be a cowboy, and be in the NFR. And it's kind of dumb, but my mom got my picture framed and of that picture, and I've carried it around for 34 years. So now that I'm here, I was so emotional. Like, the first perf, I was like crying and puking and hugging everybody. I was so excited.
Right after
I about hugged you. Yeah. You see that? I was like, Donnie, I did it. So it's
right after he puked.
Yeah, I brushed my teeth. No, I didn't. But seriously, I wish I would have. But
it gets a hold of you. You know, you just gotta lay there and take it.
Yeah, you really do. But you know, like people that all y'all that are here. I mean, so many kids that know about rodeo and stuff. I mean, it's just such that the NFR is ingrained in your head as a young kid, like. That's all you ever think about is, man, the NFR, we've got to get to the NFR. The NFR, so it's just, it's bugged me to tell you the truth. I mean, and I've had to come out here for years and watch all my friends, and one of my best friends, Drew Melvin's here in the steer wrestling, and, you know, I've got so many friends in the bull riding, and Tuckness and Chuck and everybody, you know, we all growed up together. So, I mean, to sit in the stands and watch is tough because, like, man, this is where we want to be. The NFR is where we want to be. So that's why I've been kind of on an emotional roller coaster. So if I hug you or kiss you or tell you that I love you, just go with it, okay? I'm very emotional.
I want to show everybody my favorite picture. I found this picture this summer.
Oh, Lord.
This is my favorite picture. And, guys, if you'll put it up back there, this will show you another side of his life right there.
Okay, Papa. Yeah. Pretty potent, ain't you?
I tell you what, those babies are so... I'm going to cry right now, okay? Will you take that down? I'm starting to get emotional. Yeah, you know, I got triplets, which is cool. But one thing about me rodeoing, me and my wife, Ashley, she's back there. Ashley, stand up and wave your hand so everybody can see you. She's hot. Everybody say, hey, Ashley.
Hey, Ashley.
So, actually, it's so funny. We found out we were pregnant during the Clark County Fair in Logandale. And, you know, we tried for several years, and we were in Walmart when they called us, and we're like, oh, my God, we finally did it. This is so great. And a couple weeks, well, after Corpus Christi.
Right after Corpus, yeah.
I told Donnie, I said, my wife is horribly sick. Horribly. And he said, ah, you know, she's just pregnant. That's just part of it. You know, all right, whatever. So... We go to the doctor a couple weeks later to do the thing where they have the deal. And I don't know. I wasn't paying attention a lot. And so
he's a clown.
The doctor's, I was sitting in the corner and Ashley is on the thing. And I'm sorry, honey. I don't know. And the doctor says, congratulations. You've got a, hold on. I says, everything good, doctor? Yeah. There's 3. And I go, all right. So I start clapping, and Ashley kind of passes out. I'm like, oh, my God. So I was trying to be positive, and then when we left, I go, oh, my God, what are we going to do with 3 babies? But actually, I freaked
out. Y'all were in Walmart.
I freaked out. I, like, you know in the cartoons when the guy falls over backwards and goes through the wall? I was standing, and I just bang. I mean, but they are great babies, and my wife, she is unbelievable. A lot of people don't realize about rodeo clowns. But, you know, we rodeo for 11 months solid. Like, actually, after this, next week I got the Chase Hawks in Billings, and then the next week I've got, on New Year's Eve, I got a PBR, and then I started Odessa on January 2nd. So we roll nonstop, and my wife not only takes care of those three kids on the road with me, she does all the contracts, she pays all the fuel, she gives me money when I need it, as long as it's within an appropriate range of money. So she kind of runs the whole deal. So it's pretty cool because all I really got to do is just be in the arena and be funny. So she does a lot that I don't give her enough credit. And in my defense, I've changed 7 diapers since we've been in Vegas. So
those were all yours. Yeah. No, I wanted to
holla. Sometimes,
Justin, I want you to tell them the magic marker story with the hospital. With
oh.
Just because the men will appreciate it, the women will get mad at
okay,
you.
Okay, so
again.
Yeah, how many? Just raise your hand. Do you guys have children? Raise your hand. Does anybody here have identical children? Yeah, it's pretty tough. My girls are identicals, and then my little boy, Bandy, is, you know, dead giveaway. But we got the girl.
We call them the Rumplets.
Yeah. So, you know, Bandy's, you know, you can tell he's different because he's a boy. And but Livy and Lola are identical. I'm talking about the same. Even the doctor that was in our NICU was like, man, you know, I've been a doctor for a long time. These babies look alike a lot, and they act alike. So when we got home from the hospital, I took a Sharpie and I put a mark on one's foot so I know which one was which. And I don't have to do that anymore. Now I just guess. But they are just angels. A lot of people said, they told us last year and at Corpus Christi, I was having a meltdown and blue jeans and gin, my good friends, I was crying. I'm a crier. You know that joke. I was like, oh my God, what are we going to do with these kids? And so I called one of my best friends. I called John Harrison. And I said, what am I going to do? And he said, you're going to put them in car seats and you're going to rodeo with them. And the first year we've been to like 14 states. We've flown with them 3 times. And they're not here right now. They're out playing cards. But they're with their grandma and grandpa. But we've got to rodeo with our triplets. And I cannot wait. Give me 3 years. And I'm going to have the funniest clown act you've ever seen with children. Because the way I figure it, each baby owes me $27,000
okay,
right now.
Okay, wait just a minute. I know Bronk, your dad, you grew up in this rodeo family. And, you know, my dad's a stock contractor just like yours. And it's got Pete and me and Jim. And so is it like, okay, if I have one more kid, I don't have to hire anybody for the stripping shoot. So, I mean, you got your own built-in labor crew, you know. I mean,
I'm going to give you guys a little heads up. I've already thought this up since I've been out here. Since I got one boy and 2 girls, okay? You guys get with me on this. The little boy and the 2 girls drive into the arena in one of them little, like, Tonka trucks. Bandy, my little boy, is dressed like Elvis, and my twin girls are in showgirl outfits. And he lip syncs with moves, Viva Las Vegas. Well, that'll be great, everybody. I'm for real.
Perfect.
For real.
I wanted to ask you, last night we had Junior Negueta here with us last night.
He's on my fantasy team.
And he was sitting there talking to Joe. Joe was frustrated with him because his first night he was sitting just, he wasn't ready to rope. He was just so taken in by the whole experience of being there. So your first night out there, when they introduce you, your first night, and you're looking around at 18,000 people, tears or diaper?
Both, actually. You know, as you
tell us about the tears.
As you can tell, I'm not exactly in the best shape of any rodeo clown that's ever been here. And I'm sitting there, my heart's going like this. I'm like, oh my gosh. The first thing I thought was, don't have a heart attack. I mean, which could happen. You know, I hope it don't. But, you know, it's just, it was all pretty normal for a while because I've been planning this out in my head, you know, what I'm going to do. And when the first perf, we were just sitting in the locker room with all my friends, with Cody Whitney and J.W. Harris come down and Chuck and Swish and Webster. And we're all just hanging out, cracking jokes, trying to kick each other in the head. It's a long story. And So we're sitting down there, and I was not even pumped. I'm like, oh, this is just another rodeo. And then the barrel racing started, and it got real. I'm talking about what? You know, I started walking down that deal, and my legs started going like this. And I thought, oh, my gosh, if I can't get in that barrel, Sean Davis is going to fire me right now. So I'm like, pull it together. So, yeah, I did. But you tonight did. I got a leg cramp, and my right leg went stiff, and I couldn't get in the barrel. I don't know if you guys saw that, but that was not planned. Okay?
Okay, so.
I'm feeling really low, and I need a
motivational
speech.
Oh, Lord.
That's
I'm feeling really low, and if you don't do it, I'm going to tell your wife about you. I am the new Miss Rodeo.
Boy, Polhamus is a liar. Okay?
I didn't even ask him a question. Okay?
Oh, Lord. Okay, I will give Boyd Paul. You all want to see a motivational speech?
Yes.
Okay, come on out here, Boyd. Sit in the chair. I got to take my hat out for this, okay? Sit right down. You need me? It's not the first time, okay? All right, he needs a little motivation. Here's a little motivation from my friend, Matt Foley, okay? Who's been back drinking coffee for the last 4 hours, so he should be about ready.
Okay, Boyd, how's everybody doing tonight? Good, good, good. Now, it seems like one of your rodeo announcers at the NFR has been a little bit unmotivated. Boyd, what do you want to do with your life?
I don't know.
That's the most worst answer I've ever heard from a rodeo. Can we start up? I don't know.
All right, I want to be a rodeo announcer.
You want to be a rodeo announcer? Well, that's just fine and dandy. But I'm here to tell you that as you go out there in announcing school, you won't amount to jack squat. You're probably thinking to run out in there, grab life by the tail, rip it out, and stick it in your pocket. But I'm here to tell you that as you go out there, the rodeo clown is way funnier than you are. And the Green Bay Packers suck. No, I didn't mean that. I just lost somebody off my Christmas card list. I did.
Give him a hand. Justin Rumford right there. Awesome.
It's going to be fun.
I got to know, was there money on the bet when I walked in to ask if you were able to come on our show tonight? Because I couldn't get him to speak, and he just told me. He shook his head and gave me thumbs up. But was there money on that? What was the deal?
Chuck Swisher bet me $100. I couldn't keep my mouth shut for 20 minutes.
That's when I walked in, so that's why and Cody and Dusty were trying to ask him, you know, oh, you got a rodeo contract for him to sign? Or I said, no, I'd like him to come on the show if he doesn't have already a prior commitment. And I asked him, I said, Justin, can you come on our show tonight?
For the record, I didn't win the bet.
You didn't?
I can't keep
quiet. Well, damn it, you could have answered me then.
Well, thank you, everybody. Thanks for having me out here.
Thank you, Justin. Outstanding. Our time is getting away, so I'm going to do this, you guys. I'm going to bring everybody out here at once. I'm going to bring Aaron along with Bob.
I was going to say, we got to get Aaron out here because he said, can I just sit over and drink a few beers until it's time for me to come out? And I said, sure. I had no idea we were going to be this long.
He's a 12-pack down now.
Let's get them all out here. Bull rider extraordinaire Aaron Pass is here. Let's bring Bob Tallman and Boyd Polhamus out. Everybody together. So come on out. Good. Yeah, give. Aaron, here's your microphone. Welcome. Come right over here and sit down.
Watch out, Dad. Watch that door.
Hi, guys.
Hi, guys.
Aaron, it's chaos here, by golly, and we're glad you're here with us to enjoy it. So we'll get another. There we go. We're all set.
Vic Trolla, sit down, buddy.
Thank you.
Got a tough crowd here around you, Aaron, for your first NFR, and my goodness, you are tearing it up. Talk about your first trip to the big show here.
Oh, you know, it's been good. I don't feel like I've been able to, show everybody what I can actually do. I had a few bad goes and stayed on a couple, but it's been all right. I'm not as happy as, you know, I want to be with my just two bulls that I covered, even though I did win the rounds. But, you know, I'd like to be up there higher in the average, higher in the standings.
I mean, he's won more in 16 seconds than I did winning a world title, plus what I won at that year's NFR. He's won 40 grand, you know. But, Aaron, we're going to watch a couple of your rides here in just a second. But tell them what happened to your equipment.
You know, actually, before I came up here, the week before I come up here, I went to get on some bulls at a bull riding, and unfortunately, my stuff got stolen, so I had to show up to my rookie NFR borrowing gear. The first night, my feet hit me in the ass and threw me off, and it was a little upsetting because, you know, my feet never come behind me, so I changed a little things up and won the second round, and you know, every time I come into the locker room every night, I was busy wiring my spurs, getting stuff together, and it's just been a hassle the whole time I've been here. But I feel like I've got my, you know, some as good as it could get and settled in, and I'm ready to go the next few days.
Let's take a look at you at work. Let's take a look tonight, and then we'll take a look. You mentioned round two. We'll do that in just a second. But let's talk about tonight. You and Donovan talk about this. Go ahead, Aaron.
Little white bull, man. I've been waiting to get on a bull into my hand all week. That little bull got real lucky because I was about to give him the boots and spurs, and he jumped out of it and went the other way. So really the only thing I could do was walk out of the arena with a smile on my face knowing that he outsmarted me, but that won't happen again.
Let's show the ride from round two. Go ahead anytime you want to give him a hand. I mean, this bull ride right here, but I'm going to ask you, you know, you were thinking about giving him some spurs, and he jumps out of it and reversed it. Do you think that little bit of distraction had anything to do with you not making that reversal? Because I've seen you do it 100 times, no problem.
Yeah, and, you know, to me, I don't pay attention to any of the bulls. So maybe if I watch them a little bit more, I'll be able to know. But all I knew is people said that bull goes left, and they don't ride him very often. And like I said, he turned back to the left, and I was really wanting to give it to him, and I just let him get me on the ground.
All right, well, let's just watch this one right here and go ahead and talk about it. This is such a good bull ride away from your hand. What bull is that? You remember what his name was?
Seeing Red.
Seeing Red. But how's that feel right there? Because you know you're fixing to win big money.
Actually, it didn't feel too good at all. Everybody said that bull's really good, and a lot of people know that I struggle from time to time with bulls going away from my hand. I tend to get in there and not pay attention. I'm ready to get out in the arena, and I get my hand on the side, and they throw me off. But I stayed loose and cool and calm and got out of the chute, and the bull, you know, really whirled it up right there. I had to do an old B-Rich move and stick my chin in the air, and I was either going to get stitches or get money, one of the two, and luckily I got money instead of stitches.
That's what I'm talking about. I was pumped, you know, because, I mean, you're going over your hand right there, and everything's looking good. Now watch him stick his head up in the air because he's fixing to go over the front, so he knows it's going to be money or mud, you know, and he took the money, and awfully, awfully proud. That was just a kind of a pace setter. But how was your first victory lap?
Actually, you know, the victory lap, I outran the flag girl for a reason. They wouldn't let me do the grand entry here because, you know, coming from a city, we don't ride horses much, more bicycles and things like that, low riders. You know, I got on that horse and having Donnie knows short legs, everybody else is tall, that the stirrups never match up to us. So we kind of bounce around, flop around up there. So I didn't want to do it, but all I got to say is I'm glad I did not fall off.
You know, and somebody, I don't know who it was, and we're going to get this picture and put it up at some point in time during the week, but they got a great victory lap picture of you on that horse. But we hope to get to see you a lot more. But, you know,
Donnie,
a well ride, but two first place.
I've got last night's ride, too, if you want to take a look at it.
I do. Yep. I mean, I never get tired of watching good bull rides. Yep. That's why I was so fired up tonight, man. We rode a lot of bulls. But this was one of two guys that makes the whistle. You're the first man out.
Yeah, that you know, once again, I never seen that bull. People told me he's a big old red bull, which they wasn't lying. And it always seems the smallest guy gets the biggest bull, the biggest guy gets the smallest bull. But, you know, he turned back to the right, and I didn't pull much rope in him. I kind of let him float around underneath me, and it really went good. He felt good. He kind of worked my hand out of the rope right there at the end. That's why I land on my head like that instead of my feet. But going to the, you know, down there and getting the buckle and the Pendleton and all that, it makes it feel better.
Well, I got to tell one story. He's sitting in the locker room tonight, right after, you know, the night after this ride, and he's got this icy hot, and he's sitting there in his socks, and he's got his shirt unbuttoned, and he's putting all this stuff on his neck and rubbing it on his chest and his shoulders, and somebody said, "What is that?" And he goes, "It's supposed to be able to get rid of some soreness." He said, "I would rather be putting it on the bottom of my feet, but since I don't seem to be able to land on my feet when I get off, I'm going to have to put it on my neck." You know, the locker room is a really a fun place, and I'm very privileged to be able to be in their locker room because, you know, you can get in the way. These guys are trying to make a living, but it's been a lot of fun. And a lot of it's because of guys like Aaron. They got such great attitudes. They don't mind some old fossil coming in there and asking them what their bull's going to do. And you know, they'll take time to do that, but they're also handling their business out here.
We're glad that you're with us here tonight, and I want you to stay right there. But give him a hand.
Yeah, don't
Aaron
run him
Pass
off.
Right there.
Don't
yeah.
run him off.
No, I want him to stay right here.
You
Go
said
ahead,
three Tom. Times something that I want you to get over saying. You said, "I don't pay attention very much. I don't pay attention very much." You said it three times. Get over it, okay?
Yeah.
Get over it, because here's the deal up here. If you say it, you'll think it. And the deal is, you get in the habit of saying it. "I don't like this. I don't like this. I never can do that. Never can do that." Get over it. And if you can't get over it and it don't get better for you, my wife said, "I'll buy that kid and take him home just to have him around the house to make me smile." Your eyes and your smile is infectious. So you don't have to worry about paying attention. If this bull riding thing don't work for you, I got a houseboy job for you.
I appreciate it. I can push a broom
listen,
pretty good.
That's a big obligation, because if Tallman can't keep you entertained, your boots are full. Because if Kristen is going, "Look, I got to have somebody else around here to keep me grinning," and she's got him, you're in a bind. That's what you are.
Help us out, Boyd. Tonight, what changed?
I haven't studied it that much, Dan. Really, most everything stayed the same. I did want to say something about Rump, because I was so glad when he came in and I saw him on the screen and y'all had him out here. You will never meet a more genuine human than Justin Rumford. And what's great about Justin is the guy that you saw on stage is the guy that you see in the meeting rooms at 8 a.m. And I remember telling him when he first got started, and I got to work with him a couple of times, I said, "You know, I got to work with Liesl, I got to work with Quayle, I got to work with Leon Coffey. Me and Flint did dozens of performances together." And I was 48 or 49 when Justin really started getting out there in the business. And I said, "You know what? You made it to where I want to keep going." Yeah. Knowing I get to work with a guy like you makes me want to keep going. He is just so original and so raw. And the only other thing that, and I have to do this out of the interest of full disclosure, he is without question the father of his children, okay? Okay? But I'm the one who got his wife pregnant, okay? So, Justin always gets mad because I'll tell a rodeo audience that and never go any farther, and they're like, "What?"
Well, the only reason he says that is because, you know, he's, you know, the Packer queen, you know, from Wisconsin, you know, but they go.
Yeah, you just
send
your Dallas Cowboys up
Packers
to Lambeau.
Went,
we'll see what happens.
They played in Dallas. He's got his Packer regalia on. His wife's got her Dallas Cowboy regalia on, and, you know, she has her sign whenever they're sitting next to one another. "I'm here with Stupid."
Yeah, I married Stupid. But seriously, I'm going to kick your ass in the playoffs. So that doesn't matter. But you see a guy like Aaron, who's young, and you know he's been brought up. Brian's been an influence on him. You've been an influence on him.
And I'm a Cowboys fan.
And you're a Cowboys fan. We'll get used to losing, stud.
Boyd, you got to finish your Rumford deal.
I got to tell you, I didn't knock up his wife, okay? But I was responsible for her getting pregnant. Because we're leaving Logandale, Nevada, and they got to FedEx some meds for Ashley that are going to help in this conception thing. And I'm going to Corpus. Justin's going to Corpus, but he has the misfortune of having to drive. I've got another rodeo out here a couple weeks later called El Dorado, so I'm leaving my horse and trailer out here, and I'm flying. I'm like, "No problem. FedEx them to my house. I'll bring them with me when I get to Corpus, And after Corpus, now I don't know what Ashley did and I don't know what Justin did, but I know she ended up pregnant after Corpus. And so without me,
you know, you shouldn't
have,
you should not have put the package in there that said maximum strength.
Anyway, next thing I know, there's three Justins coming out. And I'm like, I love Ashley to death, but who squeezes out three Justins? Girl or boy?
She's tough.
I'm telling you.
Now, this young man has a six-month-old daughter, correct?
I do. I got a beautiful little girl. You
did
know,
you not read the manual? I mean, it's that push and pulling section, okay? Go back to that part. Read it again. You can't make love with your eyes closed, okay?
Well, I must have messed up on that one.
But, you got to understand, on the, he's got the deal down on the push and pull, okay? Boys are made on the way out. Girls are made on the way in. Figure that one out.
Aaron, when I ask you to come to the show, I didn't know this was going to happen, I promise.
I was just going to say I should have stopped on the way in because I ended up with a woman, so I'm
you did
I must have went on the
you
way
did
out.
Good. Yeah, you did good.
Yeah. The things you learn on this show, isn't it, huh?
Can we end that?
Yes.
We should change this show to Revelations.
There's oh, my gosh.
There's a new stuff you learn here.
It's been unbelievable. I want to thank, we're out of our time here. I want to thank each and
thank
every.
Thank God, we're yes. going to jail next.
Would you give these guys a hand up here? Joe Beaver, Boyd Polhamus, Aaron Pass, Bob Tallman, Donnie Gay. Awesome. We have prizes to give away to you this evening. We're going to do that in just a second. Let us do an official goodbye with our crew out here on the cameras, and we will do that, and then have a lot of prizes to give away to you. Thank you for being here at National Finals tonight. Thank you.
Thank you for watching and attending the show. We hope you enjoyed this presentation of National Finals Tonight at the Gold Coast, where all the Cowboys go after the rodeo. We look forward to seeing you again tomorrow, same time, same place. This has been a presentation of Boyd Gaming, riding for the brand. Fun isn't over yet. We invite you to head upstairs for Gary LaFue's legendary Buckin' Ball. Live music and dancing with Las Vegas favorite, the Tony Marcus Band. Beer and drink specials, and best of all, no cover charge. We're gonna dance and party till the cows come home at the Buckin' Ball. Got a rodeo.